So hello and good evening and welcome to Beauteous Past TV. We have here today with us DP Sharma, Director, Professional Products Division of L'Oreal India. Welcome DP to Beauteous Past TV. This is really a phase in our lives that we've never experienced before, and so we all sit at, instead of going live and, meeting each other, we are kind of interviewing you here from our offices. So DP, we have been tracking L'Oreal Professional for the longest time, now almost 2 decades. And we definitely know that you've been steering the course of the development of modern salon industry in India, and deeply invested in that. And so we will start, of course, with the most natural question which comes to all of us, which is about how, in these times, this unprecedented, global crisis, COVID-19 and all that, how have you, handled, how have you been promoting the professional businesses now that, everybody is in a lockdown? And so just love to hear from you.
First of all, thanks Ritu for having me here and connecting with the audience. So thank you all for giving the time. Now coming back to the question, Ritu, how COVID-19 is actually a challenge. I mean, we know it's a big pandemic. It's impacted probably every other sector in the world, and nobody on the planet is actually untouched by it right now in terms of the economic impact. And so has been the salon industry. And specifically the salon industry, I personally feel has been impacted all the more versus all other sectors that we talk about. For the last 55 days, there hasn't been any activity in salons. We have had a very stringent lockdown, probably the biggest one on earth, with 1.3 billion people confined to their places. Thanks to government for pulling up such a strong lockdown. But yes, it came with its own set of issues and concerns for the industry. We know for sure that the business was at a standstill. There weren't any clients that that people can really entertain them. But what's happening on the side is that education is one of the bedrocks of our industry. If I talk about what has been our journey in 23 years, one of the single biggest factor that has contributed to our stability and growth has been education. So in a way, if I have to see what have we done to maximize these 55 days, I would say education is one of the things that actually stood out. So thanks to our Learn and Connect platform, which you always had with us, but off late we had live streaming, et cetera, that went ahead with it. So we utilized that platform and we trained more than 50,000 hairdressers from about 30,000 salons in these 55 days. And the journey continues. It also gives us an opportunity to connect and hear to hairdressers and beauticians at a much more personal level, because you can devote that much amount of more time. I think the personal skilling, the master classes, all of that has really gone well in these 55 days. But yeah, at the end of the day, if you talk in terms of absolute business, that wasn't that great right now. Yeah. It also had a side of opportunity that it brought on the table. Of course, the services were at a standstill, but certain to do with the retail products, basically. So we started off for the home delivery of most of our products. From the salons, we actually contacted with 12 different partners across the country who helped deliver the end product to the consumers. So all of these initiatives were being taken, but the biggest one was education that I can clearly stand out, which has been the core for 23 years for us.
That's wonderful. But we also would like to understand that while we are in the midst of this crisis, and education is you've rightly pointed out, you've already, had the system of the art certificates, the certificates with your partner salon academies that you have developed, which have been very efficiently, kind of set up to maximize the reach throughout the country. We would like to hear a little bit more about what has been done so far and what are your plans going forward.
So Earth Academy, the way we call it is Earth, is absolute root to hairdressing. That's an academy. It's a full-fledged hairdressing school that was first started by the Indian subsidiary across the globe in L'Oreal Professional Products. And it's been there since 2005 with us. And we've made a lot of inroads. So basically, the idea is to have one mother place where the students who are absolutely fresh. They can come in, they can go in for a 6 months of dedicated education courses. So somebody who's who doesn't even know how to hold a pair of scissors, they can actually come and actually learn the art of hairdressing. And by the end of 6 months, which is both theoretical as well as practical exposure and an internship within the salon, the guy comes out as a total professional out of these institutes. Not only that, there are a lot of opportunities that come for these guys who passes on from the L'Oréal Academy. Now, what we did was, after initial few years of success, we said, let's scale the model higher. So what we did was, we started contacting and we started collaborating with our local academies. So today in the country, we have around 15 local academies run by all the top chains and top salons in the country, whereby everything is governed as per the SOPs of Earth Academy that we run in Mumbai headquarters. Now, we would do the course curriculum, we would tell them the entire structure of it, the way it's going to be executed. We train their trainers. At the end of the day, they are the ones who are delivering these classes in the physical environment in their respective towns. But the assessment is actually done by our trainers. They fly down from Mumbai and they go and assess the guys there. A certification is only issued in case the guys actually qualify for that exam. And it's not an easy one, I can tell you. Not many would qualify. Average about 75 to 80% of people actually move on to the next level. So yeah, it's very stringent. And one of the reasons why it's stringent, because the quality is very, very, very controlled. And that's the reason there's a lot of demand for the students who pass out from these institutes. And they're actually employable the moment they jump out of these academies. So much so that some of them have actually been our trainers for the longest period of time. So we do have some internal requirements, which we take. And of course, to the industry, they go back and there are some entrepreneurs who start their own ventures. And some of them join hands with the leading salon chains.
Fantastic. So going forward, are you planning to expand this route of trainings and education, or you also have big bandwidth with Matrix? You have a huge footprint with Matrix, and even otherwise there are 47 education centers that you have across the country. So I just like to understand this piece, how you these integrate all this together.
So we can do a lot with education, and specifically given the skill opportunity that we have in India, we personally believe if we really tie up the education at different levels, we can really go much, much deeper. So at the top notch, as I spoke to you about the Earth Academy, that's where we have 15 partners. Yes, the plan is there for expansions in future, because we know it's the most controlled and the most qualitative output that we really get from the Earth Academies. Yeah. You correctly mentioned that we have 47 education centers. And between these education centers and the shows that we conduct, we usually train around 3.5 lakh hairdressers and beauticians every year. Now, is that scalable? Yes, that's scalable. But there's also a rate limiting factor when you try and do the physical education. So the next era, which is also an opportunity for us, is about the digitization of education. And I was just speaking to you about the Learn and Connect app, where we have more than 170,000 hairdressers which are registered with us. We connect to them on a daily basis. So we have really scaled from a micro level to a 6 months course to a half a day express courses when we're talking about digital education. We can also scale it up thanks to the government initiative with the beauty and wellness skill sector, whereby we'll be partnering to create certain center of excellence. This center of excellence would then have an influence over the regional academies. And from there, we can really scale up the education as well. So different stratas, we have different academies and different methods of integrating these students. But for sure, the opportunity in education is huge. We are already training 3.5 lakh hairdressers every year. I think millions is what I can say. We can see in next 2 to 3 years, I should be touching about a million hairdressers very, very quickly.
Okay, fantastic. So that's great news for the industry about, because as you understand, under lockdown, we have suddenly realize that there are 70 lakh people with this industry, you know, directly or indirectly employees, and we have not taken into account the huge barber community, you know, which spreads across countries, across villages and towns. So, you know, there's a huge task at hand, I think, for the people in business. So we, going forward, we'd love to hear about, you know, the government has, MSME has recently declared that, you know, let's be vocal about local, you know, and L'Oreal, we know that has been manufacturing for the longest time in India. So how do you convey this message? Because L'Oreal, as the word conveys, it's an imported brand. You know, that's what comes in the mind of people and maybe even the government. So how? What is your take on this? How are you going to send out this message?
Yes, L'Oreal is a multinational organization. We are present across the globe, no doubts on that. But when you talk more specifically about the Indian context, I can tell you we have a full ecosystem within the country. We have two manufacturing facilities. We have two research and innovation centers in the country. We have a massive network of people. We employ more than 5,000 people directly and indirectly into our places. We manufacture more than 90% of our products that we sell in the country, within the country. On top of that, we also export to 9 countries apart from India that we are consuming. So in all true sense, we are actually very, very relevant locally, because most of the developments of our brand have actually been done, taken into consideration the Indian skin tones and the Indian hair types. We continue to invest in the industry, in the country, we continue to train. So it's about skilling. So the core essence of it is actually very, very Indian. But yeah, it's a multinational company across geographical presence over the globe.
Okay. You know, we have spoken about training, we've spoken about manufacturing in India. So moving on, we are very much interested in understanding DP about, the Indian Hairdressing Awards. You know, you have built it as a platform that recognizes the best of talent and the kind of work that, you know, that walks the ramp and at these shows I have seen personally. So I would like to hear more about what's going on with IHA, and this year is all lockdown. I'm wondering what's happening with the platform, and you know, and how you want to make it maybe even bigger than what it is.
Okay. Sure. So I'll just take you a brief into the history. So we started the IHA as an earlier avatar of Colour Trophy. So we had 4 editions of Colour Trophy before we made it as an IHA, which is the Indian Hairdressing Awards, in 2014 and 15. And earlier it was a single award, which was the Colour Trophy, but we actually built in not only the Colour Trophy, but also the curtain style and also the business award into it. And we also integrated the consumer's feedback as well. So it actually then holistically was a mechanism where both art, beauty, and the business was being recognized. We've been doing it in the country for a very long time right now, but last year was the first time it went international, and we did the first overseas event in Dubai. This is a platform which gives the best of the talents to show their creativity, get their recognition, also get some world-class exposure in terms of further, if they really want to sharpen their acumen in hairdressing. Going forward for this particular year, we are all in a state of lockdown. All I can say is that we do have initial plans to launch IHA right now. But there are no plans right now that I can tell you that we are parking it or we are not going to have it. We'll still wait and watch. And probably in a couple of months from now, we'll have a better clarity to take it forward. But we know that the artistic edge that that L'Oreal brings on the table needs to be there. To that effect, if I just may add to it, Matrix, I actually done a hair transformer as an event last year, whereby it was also a competition, but was it entirely done digitally. So all the entries were done digitally, all the assessments were done digitally. The 10 shortlisted entries across the country was being called to Mumbai, and we worked with KOLs on their hair, and that's how we actually spread our message across the fraternity. So we did had a lot of entries digitally as well. I'm not saying that IH is going to go digital, because last time when we did, we had more than 1500 entries physically. But yes, that's that we are present in both digital and the physical world from the division's point of view.
And you do have a dream team that, you know, has been inspiring and educating all across the country. Does this concept grow any bigger, the dream team that you have? Do you plan to take it, make it bigger, or you know, or scale it, you know, a little more?
So Dream Team is a group of very artistic people, very specialized people who are there for a reason, because they're one of the best in the industry. They are trying to help the other industry partners to come up and get trained on the latest fashion cuts, color and styling. We created this group decades back. We're still a very small group of six people. But what we have is also our ID artist. So these ID artists are actually the second set of best guys, and young people. We are very dynamic, very ambitious, very creative. So we are also polishing this this set of people too. So eventually some of them would qualify into the dream team, and that's how we have a progression there. The answer on do we want to expand dream team? If we have good talent and good artistic people, why not? But that's something that we would leave it to the artists to decide.
Sure. So taking the cue from the previous response of yours, that you're working with B&W SSC, I would love to understand how you, you know, look at the industry going forward. What do you think is going to happen out there? And what should be done to, you know, catalyze the, you know, developments in the salon industry?
So it's $1 million question, Ritu. What's going to happen in the times to come? As I said, nobody has actually not been impacted by COVID, at least economically. So going forward, first of all, let me tell you how the industry was before. So it was a very strong double-digit growth for all these decades that we've been working. For the last two decades, we've been rocketing in terms of the growth, thanks to the consumer awareness and the demand for beauty, which was always increasing. They're well-connected. We do expect that this trajectory would continue, albeit there'll be a pause, which is right now a phase that we are going through. But from short to midterm, the industry is going to bounce back. And the reason why it's going to bounce back is because beauty is a necessity today. It isn't a luxury anymore, which used to be 2 to 3 decades back. Today, if people have to socialize, if they have to go to offices, even if they have to step out of the home, they feel more confident when they are wearing the beauty and the products. So I do think that it's going to bounce back. Yes, it's going to be a bit of a pause, which the phase that we are right now going through, but it's going to be there. But two key aspects that I would want to highlight is one is the psychological safety of the consumer. So all of us, including the industry partners, would really need to work very strongly on generating and, or rather regenerating the confidence in terms of the psychological safety that I'm entering into a premises which is 100% secure. So that's the first thing that really needs to be actually focused on. The second piece would also be in terms of how you will manage the business now, because we know the norms of social distancing, hygiene, etc. There's going to be a cost implication as well. So how you will manage your structure of P&L, that's also going to be a very important aspect. So for me, there are two big takeaways: the consumer psychological safety, and the second piece is about how you will restructure your businesses, taking into consideration the long-term impact of this industry.
So I believe that you already had some trainings going on for the COVID bit of it, you know, about the sanitization, etc., which is going to be a cause and added cost. So do you think the business numbers will, I mean, but I think the business will go down for people in this financial year. And now, is there anything that you suggest that they would do? Like, normally what retail is not so big in India, in salons. So is there anything of all the years that, you know, you've kind of so creatively contributed to this industry? I would like to understand whether you consider a few things absolutely pertinent for people that they should adopt in their, you know, practices in their businesses, which will help them, you know, come out of these times.
So one of the key aspects, as you currently pointed out, is the retail aspect. So there's a sizable contribution for some salon chains, but I think the scope is still much more. So if you really talk about an initiative that we have taken right now, it's about the social commerce, which I was explaining that now the delivery of products at the home, that is what the new normal is in the given times of crisis. Now, is that going to be temporary? I don't think so, because now you've already tasted a success. So we have trained more than 10,000 people on deliveries at home. We have integrated 12 different partners. So all of this machinery is in place. And that initiative is now going to see a long way during the normal circumstances as well. So that's one thing. You need to reinvent the business. You need to change with time. At the same point of time, I would also want the industry to understand that all of us have to come together and we need to reignite the confidence. The moment we can reignite the confidence, that's the time this industry will start seeing a double-digit growth as well. So there, I think the partners need to take initiatives, reach out to consumers, personally convince them. I mean, we have had our own set of assets that we are sharing with consumers as well as with hairdressers for them to push these assets to consumers to at least go through it, and they can really see that, okay, it's not only being talked about, it's actually getting executed in the salon. So in the first phase, these are the two most critical elements. Going forward, I do see a lot of change in the value add of services that is being bought upon, because we usually used to see a lot of discounting that used to happen. I don't think that would be the way forward. The real value add to the consumer needs to be driven. There would be ways and means of delivering the same service in much more efficient and a different way. I mean, home services, it's a big question mark whether they're going to increase or reduce after that. Nobody has an answer to that. But that's also an aspect which probably might grow in times to come. So there are multiple facets and multiple opportunities that exist both with in terms of retail as well as services. And people really need to adapt to these changing circumstances.
Finally, what are the few learnings personally you think being in this industry you've had, and how do you keep applying them to your, your role as a professional in our industry, which is so heavily, run by women, and it employs 65% of the people here are women, and a lot of migrants. So there's a lot of good things that this industry ends up doing, and empowering a lot of people. So just tell me a few things on that count.
So firstly, it gives me a lot of satisfaction when I see that what we are doing is actually trying to skill the industry. We are trying to impart education. It's a very noble cause for me. So it's personally very, very satisfying. Right now, when the crises are there, this has taken a bit of a backseat, but I can tell you that we can always have opportunity in crisis. So it's the way we reinvent ourselves. It's the way that we think on the new ways that really is going to drive the industry, basically. For me, if I say there are initiatives that we have taken, there are crisis times, we need to keep calm, we need to have patience, we need to take the lead as a market leader, and we need to really handhold salon and the industry to take it to the next level. So I think in totality, if you ask me, my experience has been holistic. I've been the son of the soil. I've been in this industry for more than 21 years. And I've seen those days when, let's say, the Mehndi and other products were being applied to a complete transformation, where today we have a hair coloration which is charged anywhere between 10 to 15,000 rupees as well. So the journey has been there, and I don't think that the journey is going to stop. It's just going to be a different way and a different method, the way we're going to be adopting it. Digital revolution is also impacting us, and that's going to be a key driver for us in terms not only to our communication, it's also about how the way consumers are going to choose their products and services. The social image of a salon is also going to be something that people are going to look on. So these are my personal things where I really want to focus in terms of digitizing the industry, taking the education to the next level with the help of digitization. So a couple of things that have really helped me personally during the time of crisis are these, the digitization and going forward.
Thank you, DP Sharma. It was wonderful having you with us at Beauty as Fast TV. And we will hopefully continue to get the scoops from you every time there's something to give. Yeah.
Thanks a lot, Ritu. Thanks a lot, audience, for giving your time to me. All the best for the times to come.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Pleasure.